GOES-16 is now in orbit, delivering imagery that is already proving itself valuable for improving the detection of environmental phenomena that directly affect public safety. One of the more unheralded applications is the improved capacity to identify and communicate critical information regarding the evolution of wildfires. A prime example of this immediate impact on National Weather Service decision support services occurred in the Great Plains on March 6th and 7th, 2017. On Monday, March 6th, a cold front and dry line were advancing across the Central Plains at about 20 miles per hour. The Storm Prediction Center highlighted an area of extreme fire danger ahead of the front due to strong winds, warm temperatures, and low relative humidity within a region characterized by very dry fuels. These volatile conditions prompted the issuance of red flag warnings from Nebraska to the Texas Panhandle. Before discussing how the new spectral channels available with GOES-16 improved our weather support, let's take a quick look at how the increased temporal and spatial resolution benefits forecasters. Here is a loop comparing satellite imagery at various time steps. The left column depicts GOES-13 imagery every 15 minutes. This is the standard scan rate for GOES-13 and GOES-15 imagery today. GOES-16 data are presented in the other two columns, at 5-minute intervals in the middle column and 1 minute on the far right. For all three loops, the top row comprises visible imagery superimposed with a shortwave infrared band that is tuned to detect heat signals from wildfires. Across the center is that fire channel alone, and the bottom row is a new spectral band available only on GOES-16. This band is useful for differentiating fires that are exceptionally hot and bright. As we watch this animation, a few obvious observations stand out. For instance, with more frequent time steps, you get a much stronger sense of fluid motion that reveals many nuanced details that are indiscernible in lower resolution loops. On March 6th, this gave forecasters a greater understanding of how the approaching cold front would interact with and influence wildfire evolution. Another distinct advantage of GOES-16 is that its higher spatial resolution translates into more fires being detected at an early stage in development. For example, notice that GOES-16, shown here on the right, indicates a fairly large and hot wildfire underway at 1812 UTC along the Kansas-Oklahoma border, and a second one in western Kansas. The corresponding image from GOES-13, taken 3 minutes later, barely registers the presence of those fires. In addition, the more accurate thermal readout from GOES-16 allows us to see more detail about local areas of more intense heat. The ability to identify where large fires are hottest can have important implications on fire behavior and volatility. In a moment, we will look at how new spectral channels promise to enhance that capability. So far, we've concentrated on imagery that is available on both current GOES and GOES-16. Now let's turn our attention to advantages offered by some of the new spectral bands. The current generation of GOES has only one visible channel. GOES-16 has two. In this image from 6 March 1922 UTC, the traditional visible band is depicted on the upper left. The central wavelength of this band is in the red part of the visible spectrum, and the sheer fact that this channel has a spatial resolution of 500 meters makes it extremely useful for a variety of purposes. But focus for a moment on the area within the blue oval in southern Kansas. Notice how much more prominent the large fire plume is on the upper right panel. This is the second visible channel, with a central wavelength in the blue portion of the spectrum. Because it is particularly sensitive to aerosols, constituents like dust, haze, air pollution, and fire smoke stand out more, even though the spatial resolution is slightly more coarse at 1 kilometer. The bottom panels depict spectral channels especially useful for fire diagnosis. On the bottom left is the 3.9 micron fire hotspot band that we looked at previously. On the bottom right is new imagery from the GOES-16 2.2 micron band. This imagery has several useful applications. including distinguishing land cloud properties, particle size, identifying snowpack, and detecting extremely hot fires embedded within larger complexes. For purposes of this talk, we'll focus on that last application and refer to it as the intense fire band. If we now animate the scene from about 1 to 6 p.m. local time, some important evolutionary features begin to emerge. We can see rapid intensification as the cold front overtakes the existing fires. Pyrocumulus develops in association with the deeper lift, and the fires shift their direction of spread toward the southeast. This has an enormously important impact on firefighting decisions, from positioning of resources to strategies for attack and containment. Behind the front, there's a significant increase in new fire starts. Hot spots and point sources of the plumes give evidence to their locations. Some of the smoke from hotter fires gets elevated enough to be carried aloft into the southwest flow above the frontal surface. And near the end of the loop, as the sun gets low, a broad area of blowing dust sweeps across western Kansas, reducing visibilities to near zero in some locations. Stopping the loop at 2252 UTC presents a good snapshot of these conditions. Note how the fire plumes serve as tracers of the low-level flow. You can also see the large swath of airborne dust over northwestern Kansas. And near the front, overshooting tops and gravity waves associated with the pyrocumulus convection are clearly evident, along with bright flashes in the intense fire band indicating where the hottest fires are located. As valuable as these individual channels are, sometimes it's useful to combine multiple spectral bands into a single image composite to bring out particular details, as this loop illustrates. The bottom left panel is a composite image that merges three spectral bands in a way that accentuates land characteristics, such as vegetation types and river valleys. This combination depicts large fires in shades of red and differentiates smoke from cloud more effectively than the visible channel alone. The fire plume is black, whereas clouds have a white or slightly blue tint. On the bottom right, we've combined three different bands whose wavelengths are effective detectors of fire temperature. The resultant composite reveals relative intensity. Red fires are the coolest in relative terms. Yellow fires are moderately hot, and white are the hottest. Fires that are becoming exceptionally hot are usually more volatile and unpredictable. If spreading through a fuel source like grasslands, those are the areas most likely to accelerate suddenly. Notice, as night begins to fall, we lose a lot of information from these panels. This is because they rely on solar reflectance. However, the image in the bottom right is capable of detecting reflected light from the hottest of the fires, so it can continue to provide utility for monitoring the growth and movement of these features, even after sundown. To illustrate that, we'll zoom in on that fire temperature composite and display a loop that extends to about 11 p.m. local time. Notice there are dramatic nighttime changes evident in Boeing segments at several locations along and behind the front. The average forward propagation of the fire line was about 10 miles per hour. In a couple of localized areas, the fires suddenly surged ahead at almost twice that speed. This type of vector change can be deadly. Even a few minutes' advance notice could potentially save lives. That was exactly the attitude taken by the Dodge City Forecast Office. They took the initiative to communicate what they were seeing via GOES-16 in hopes that it would prove useful to firefighters. Aaron Johnson, the Dodge City Science and Operations Officer, summarized it this way. "This was an excellent hands-on demonstration of the capability GOES-16 imagery provides to detect wildfires in real time and how to quickly apply this data for IDSS. We were calling local officials, and in some cases, it was the first notification they had of these fires, even before they got 911 calls. Given how overwhelmed these rural counties were, they were very thankful for the heads up. They told us they were able to begin planning evacuations before the fires turned due to the wind shift. I'm not sure how aware they would have been that day without us calling them directly. This quote from Kathryn Hernandez of the Kansas Division of Emergency Management underscores the value of those calls. She said, "I want to express my appreciation for the proactive efforts by the Dodge City National Weather Service Office in support of Clark County and Comanche County during the Starbuck wildfire. They provided vital information needed to direct firefighting efforts in progress, as well as planning for upcoming operational periods." Later she adds, "We have grown increasingly dependent on Dodge City. They are one of the strongest partners we have in emergency management to keep our first responders and citizens safe." In total, there were 6 fatalities and more than 1 million acres of destruction caused by these fires. Regionally, it was a headline news story for several days. But loss of life could have been far worse had it not been for the decisive actions by emergency managers and the courageous efforts of firefighting teams. And the effectiveness of those responders, by their own admission, was directly enhanced by the continuous flow of information from National Weather Service forecasters. As this case demonstrates, real-time availability of GOES-16 data is a game-changer for wildfire support. It enhances our value to decision-makers by improving our capability to anticipate rather than react to developing weather, and to communicate critical, time-sensitive impacts to decision-makers on the ground. In addition to offering valuable expertise for planning, the GOES-R era enables WFO forecasters and IMETs on site at fire camps to provide services that are tactical in nature. And all these factors have a direct impact on our collaboration with key deep relationship partners toward achieving our common goal of working together to save lives, protect property, and build a weather-ready nation.